Welcome everyone, as we abide in the court of the Dharma King. Dharma means spiritual protection. Protection, but specifically it's really referring to spiritual protection, Dharma. To protect the mind from insanity. That's spiritual protection. So the Dharma King is the potency of spiritual protection. So welcome to the court where the spiritual protection is very potent. And what we do here is we trouble ourselves with good news. Okay, that's a discipline. We intentionally do this. Now, most of us would say, well, why should we trouble ourselves with at all? Because we have this terrible continuity fear. And we're troubled by bad news. Troubled by paranoia, really, in this dream of trying to separate from God. And the only way out of this trouble, of this continuity fear, we're afraid to drop this being troubled. You know, we've been troubled for so long. We say, if I had no trouble at all, that would freak me out. So the way back is you have to trouble yourself. Be troubled with great good news. And get familiar with that good news, and then finally you say, oh, that's no trouble at all. Not being troubled is no trouble at all for me. Ultimately, this is the way, this is the only way, ultimately. However you focus on being troubled by good news, I mean, there's many ways you can label this. It's all similar, right? It's all in the same focus, actually. Be troubled by the great good news. We don't have to dream at all, actually. I've had 3 nights in a row of terrible dreams. Nightmares, horrible stuff. This is the dream of absurdity. Absurdity is trying to get rid of paranoia. Imagine that. Absurdity is basically... it's inherently paranoid. It's afraid of reality. Of course, it cannot. If it separates from reality, it's afraid of annihilation, an abyss. So let's try to say, well, we've got to find a way to be separate from reality, except it's not an abyss of non-being. And so it's paranoid. Like, oh my gosh, how do I do this? I'm really terrified that. And it's trying to get rid of that, so it makes the sacrificial world, sacrificial bodies, and these bodies are just sacrificial offerings of absurdity to try and get rid of paranoia. It projects paranoia onto these bodies, fear onto everything, makes it temporary, and then they all die, and say, okay, see, it's gone now. And so this is a horrible, horrible dreams, and I said this morning, the Holy Spirit told me, I was trying to get an answer to this dream, trying to figure it out, and the Holy Spirit says, you don't need to dream at all. You don't need to dream. I realized that you're right. I fell into dreaming as I identify with this world. This world is everyone here is just dreaming. And the dreams are one of extreme absurdity and paranoid fear, and the fear keeps creeping in, and we gotta fix it, constantly struggling. But Holy Spirit says, you don't need to dream at all. Now that's great good news, isn't it? So this is what we really focus on in the court of the Dharma King, in the presence of this great spiritual protection. The high ground. We don't need the high ground. Isn't a matter of hiking up into some high mountains. I was on a mount in the mountains on a trail, and I hiked the trail, and then I ran the trail part of it a little bit. But I realized, you know, this isn't it. This is not what we're getting at. That's a silly, absurd way of looking at it. The high ground is spiritual, high ground of spiritual protection. Spiritual protection is to be troubled by great good news, and the great good news we're saying here is that we don't need to dream at all. We don't need to fix anything in a dream. We just need to stop dreaming. As long as we're dreaming, really will be paranoid. Of what? The end of the dream, of course. Thinking that it's an abyss. The logic of absurdity tells us it's an abyss. Because absurdity says, well, I'll fall into an abyss then. But the rope is just pretending to be the snake. There's never been any snake there, actually, at all. There's never been any absurdity, self-existent absurdity at all. It's only pretense. All of this is just pretending. Pretending doesn't have any self-existent nature at all. It's never there. So, everything's always been perfect. We've never fallen from grace. We've never fallen at all. Nothing's ever fallen. We're trying to fix fallenness. That's absurdity. There's never been any fallenness. How can anything fall out of its intrinsic spaciousness? Out of its own intrinsic, unique intrinsic spaciousness? How can anything fall out of that? It cannot. So we're troubled by, we trouble ourselves because we're so used to trouble, we can't just drop trouble. We theoretically, we can, pragmatically, we don't. Nobody does. Because we say, well, it's an abyss, there's no trouble here. It must be an abyss. I must have, what happened to absurdity? How did I get rid of it? There's no trouble here. I'm not used to that. And then we freak out. So, we're here to be very much troubled by good news. This is the way. This is the way. And we might complain, say, I'm tired of being troubled. Yeah, but just try then having no trouble whatsoever. And then you'll say, whoa. I'm not used to that. And then you go to absurdity and say, hey, absurdity, what is that? And absurdity says, well, that's the abyss. You know, stay away from the abyss. Well, it would be an abyss for absurdity if absurdity was self-existent, but it's not. There's never been any separation from causation. At all. Pretending that there's separation from causation is just pretending. We don't have to do anything to fix pretending. We just have to stop pretending. We're the ones, when we stop pretending, there's still causation. We're just not causing pretending. We're causing and are experiencing. You could say, I have no pretending. So, in the court of the Dharma King, there are Dharma princes who talk like this, who trouble us with good news, who trouble us with good news, and that's the discipline. I don't have to dream at all. I don't have to dream at all. Look at that. That's flipping the script. Not, how do I fix the dream, but I don't need to dream at all. I don't need to dream. So I don't need to have nightmares, because I don't, you can only have nightmares if you're dreaming. I don't need to dream at all. So this is like, wow. This is a wow type of recognition. The Dharma princes bring us to wow, help trigger that wow. That's their role, what part of their role. Now it's getting rough in the world, isn't it? That's why we gotta trouble ourselves, shift our trouble, being troubled over to the great good news. If you didn't have Dharma princes, they didn't have Dharma kings and queens. If you didn't have that, Dharma princesses, it's also, you could say that too. We'd be in bad shape. I mean, there's always the Holy Spirit, but we'd like to have some reassurance in various ways. We can bring ourselves to wow. Absolutely we can. That's what I do. I mean, that's by trying to help others, I bring myself to the wow. I trouble myself with the good news because I'm bringing the good news here to the world. So I get troubled by this good news, and that helps me get familiar with it. So, wow, I mean, I don't have to dream at all. 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 Welcome to the court of the Dharma King. In the court of the Dharma King, we trouble ourselves with good news, with great good news, wonderful good news, troublesome good news. It's so good, it's troublesome. You say, well, wait a minute. If that's true, I won't have any trouble. That's right. And that's very troublesome for us. But we have to get used to this. So this is the discipline. So just get used to this. Just let this sink in. Oh, okay, I won't be without troubles here. I won't be without troubles. Oh, good, good. I'm just troubled with the wow now. I just have this wow. I don't have to dream. Wow. Wow, without a center, without a circumference, without a middle ground. Just wow. All troubles, really, other than the continuity trouble, have to do with dreaming. Reality, there's no troubles in reality at all. Only if we want to believe there is, then we have to dream about it. Imagine it. Make believe. Pretend. But pretending isn't really a trouble, a self-existent trouble at all. We can end that pretense instantly. And that's what absurdity is so paranoid of. Absurdity says, how can I feel there's some threat to my existence, but I can't figure out what it is, so I have to try to personify it and then get rid of it. So we personify this threat to absurdity, presumed threat, by imagining bodies and selves, an I self, I am the body, the world, all this stuff. We fixate on this personification so that we put the threat there to annihilation of absurdity. Absurdity, believing it's self-existent, feels that reality is a threat to annihilate it. But it doesn't know where this threat is coming from, actually, because it can't admit that it's just mere pretense, and the ending of pretense is what it's really afraid of. It says no, that, you know, it can't admit that it's just the mind pretending. So it says I don't know where it is. I can't quite locate it, so I've got to start fixating it somewhere, so I can then believe I'm getting rid of it. So, we've imagined, we've dreamed up bodies and worlds, and these are imagined fixations. We fixate the threat onto those bodies and worlds, and then have them die, and we think, oh, I got rid of some of the threats. We think we're getting rid of the threat here by all these bodies dying. And we have to fixate on it. Otherwise, it doesn't seem as if that the threat is there. You know, that's where the trouble is. So we could kill it, and then we think the threat's gone. Because the threat is this free-floating anxiety. We don't know what the threat is. Because we're denying our own authorship of absurdity. So we say, well, that can't be it. So where is it? I don't know. Instead of just this complete paranoia, we try to get rid of this just paranoia. The paranoia just says, wow, just everything is threatening. We try to fixate on just this body. This is where the threat is. And don't worry, we'll kill the body eventually. The body's going to die. We think, oh, good, it's going to disappear. But we want the body to seem to have a life and experiencing, and that which then ends. And then we say, okay, it's this potential threat to me has ended. So we view the body, we invest the body with this feeling of potential threat to absurdity. All right, and then we have the body die, and then absurdity says, oh, Great. Look at that. This is what's going on here. What we're doing right now in the world is we're working to expand the fixation. Okay, so we're having trouble with paranoia as we expand our fixation into a larger theater, which we think, you know, is going to be more helpful for us. Not just human bodies, but also ET bodies, and make the form seem a little less form, you know, bigger, cosmic scope. You know, so we're trying to fixate more cosmically now. Which is, it's even worse, you might say. It's like, okay, the whole, become more aware of the universe. Okay, the whole thing is good. We have more to fixate upon now. And more threats to deal with. And that feels, then paranoia feels like, our absurdity says, oh, good. I was having trouble getting rid of it with just killing these bodies, but there are a lot more bodies and worlds to kill. We're trying to kill this world, and we're getting there. But we're thinking, well, but that still doesn't feel like it's going to solve the problem. Oh, great. There's many, many more worlds and places. Oh, great. A lot of more places to kill. We can have bodies everywhere and kill all those bodies. And this will really solve the problem. So, this is what we're going through right now. So there seems to be some instability. It's just more of the same. This is one way to look at it. Be troubled by this. So when you watch these videos, don't think you won't be troubled. Of course you'll be troubled. That's the whole point of it. This is the ordeal of it. If you want to get in shape, what do you got to do? You got to hike up a mountain or something, right? I mean, that's troublesome. It's not about just trying to abide in bliss. Yoga posture, breathing, concentration, those are trance states. That doesn't do anything, actually. That's what Buddha realized, that trance states don't work, and then trying to mortify the body, that doesn't work. It doesn't work. So ultimately, we have to be troubled by the good news and get familiar with it. Familiarity is really the answer. It's not there's someone in bliss or someone's fixing something by using bliss to fix something. Then nothing has ever fallen. This is different. It's a different recognition. Don't fixate on no fixation. Is what we're going towards. No fixation on no fixation. We can fixate no fixation in a trance state. But then there's still paranoia about, well, what if I stop fixating? No fixation. I'll be annihilated. You know, if you're not. So that doesn't work. That's what Buddha discovered. He went through all these trance states of mental fixations, of fixating on no fixation. And then he said, ah, no, it doesn't work. So let me mortify the flesh. That maybe that's the problem. And find some way to get rid of paranoia by attacking the flesh, right? And so went that path and tried all of these different techniques to look at the body as terrible and negative. And, you know, so to concentrate the fixation of threat, paranoia of threat of annihilation on the body, Okay. And that didn't work. And he said, oh, finally he realized that it's neither one of those. Don't fixate on no fixation. No fixation on no fixation. Now, so what evolved from this, for instance, Tibetan Buddhism, is they have three basic ultimate steps, you might call it. Basic ultimate. Trekcho, something like they call it, like give a name to it. That's cutting through the knot of absurdity. You see, the absurdity of trying to solve absurdity, trying to fix absurdity, trying to heal absurdity. It's like, you know, getting rid of the snake in the coil of rope, and you say, well, there's got to be a way to get rid of that snake. That's taking the snake as self-existent. So you cut through the knot of absurdity by a very keen mind, very clear mind. And then you abide in what? Rigpa. Is seeing things as they are in the now. But there's still a subtle fixation on that. And the final step is togal, to drop the fixation on no fixation. And this is the Ati Yoga, this is the Dzogchen, this is the highest, this is the apex yoga, this is, but we just are aware of this, okay? So we bring it into the mix here, we're troubled by it. So we allow ourselves to be troubled by this. No fixation on no fixation, no fixation on no fixation. But we don't fixate on that, do we? See, we don't say, okay, I got it, I'm fixing. See, fixation is the attempt to get rid of threat. And absurdity feels very threatened. How can it not feel threatened? It's trying to claim that reality doesn't exist. How can a non-threatened position of claiming that reality exists, how can that not be a threatened position? It's inherently threatened completely, isn't it? There's no way for that to not be a threatened position. To deny that reality exists is like an abyss, taking the position of an abyss. So we're taking the position of being an abyss, of non-being, and then trying to separate that out to non-being, abyss of non-being, and a feeling of fear, threat, or paranoia. Being threatened, but not knowing where then we say, well, I don't know where the threat's coming from. It's not coming from taking a position of non-being. If it's so, because that's not threatened. Because we're denying reality exists. So where's the threat coming from? So we have to fixate, we have to see the threat coming from somewhere to just keep ourselves from just saying, I can't take this anymore. It's just too hideous. And then accept, you know, realize, oh, this is just absurdity. Reality does exist. So we feel we need to fixate somehow. So even we'll fixate on non-fixation. So the habit of fixation is very central to our experiencing what we've been engaging with for so long. So we introduce the idea of no fixation, even on no fixation. It's like, wow, that's really flipping the script for us, isn't it? So temporarily that makes us nervous. We might want to go back into the dreaming. Say, dreaming is just fixation. That's all it is, really. So we're just looking at how does fixation arise? Why are we fixating? And we're just, you know, we just looked at it. And we don't, all you have to do is just look at it, and then just, wow. You don't have to do anything else. We have to understand it, because that's fixation. Understanding is fixation, actually. Does reality need to understand itself? No. It is itself. It is itself. There's no need for any understanding. We don't need an understander. So to fixate on fixation is like saying, well, there's still an understander of fixation. That's what Buddha realized. Well, I got this trance state of no fixation, but there's still someone who's fixated on the no fixation, the understander of it. So that's still an absurdist context. And then he said, okay, let's get rid of the body. The body is something I'm fixating on. That's the fixator. Let's get rid of the fixator on no fixation. But that's still fixating on getting rid of the fixator on no fixation. That's still fixation. They said, oh, that's not it too. Oh. So when we pop out of this, you know, realize I don't need to dream at all, what do? Well, you're a Dharma prince at that point, or princess, and you just help everyone be troubled by the good news. Help them with that. You don't have to fixate. Teaching doesn't have to be fixation, or helping, encouraging doesn't have to be fixation. You just help them, you know, wow. Help them with the wow practice, really. Yeah, we don't have to put it into absurdist context. We can be Buddha. Simple recognition of our true nature as it is called Buddha. It's not a person, so per se. It's just simple recognition of our intrinsic spaciousness, our intrinsic nature, is given the term Buddha. One who recognizes our true nature. One who is recognizing, abiding in true nature. So it's just Buddha mind. You say Buddha mind, Christ mind, same thing, true nature. Simple recognition of our true nature. The thing is, here's the gist of it. That doesn't fix the trouble, right? Right? Everyone's still troubled. And they think, oh, I need to go fix it, go back into absurdist context. No, we don't, because what we do is help us shift to being troubled by the good news. Like, hey, I'm free. And people always say, well, that's really troublesome. I mean, I could be free too. Yeah, that's very troublesome. So you focus on that troublesomeness, and you don't fix it. You wow it. You don't fix it. You just wow it. Like, wow. No fixing. No effort to fix anything is the wow. No effort to fixate or do anything. Just I'm no center, no circumference, no in between. You're not trying to fix anything or do anything. You're just committed to non-doing, you might say. And that way, you can abide as a Dharma prince or princess. You can just abide in as Buddha, one who has a recognition of our intrinsic being, intrinsic nature. That's it. But in order to do that, one has to see this. The crux of this is that everyone will still be troubled. You won't get rid of their continuity fear by being Buddha, being a Buddha, being a Christ. Because you got to recognize, well, the continuity fear is still there. So you help them. So you can't fall into the belief that you need to fixate your realization somehow for them, okay? And so they won't be troubled. No, they will be troubled. See, this is the mistake we've made. Is you come into the world and you think, oh, I'm coming as Buddha mind, and I'm going to Christ mind, I'm going to teach, help everyone, and yet they're all troubled by this. And you think, oh, it's terrible. They're still troubled. What, you know, I came here to make the people feel good, and now they're so troubled still. And then you get caught into trying to fixate to help them, because they feel if I could just fixate it, I'll feel a lot better. And then the whole thing, you know, you get pulled down into absurdity and fixation and the personality and dreaming. You get pulled into dreaming. We don't need to dream. We don't. I don't need to dream. Say it. I don't need to dream. So it's a recognition of the continuity fear with being troubled and fixation, the desire to fixate. And then now what we're doing is being troubled by no fixation. And ultimately, no fixation on no fixation. Be troubled by that. Okay, so it's not like people are going to love you and say, oh, this is wonderful. No, they're going to say, oh, you're stressing me. It's very troublesome. And you say, yeah, great. But be troubled by good news. This is the whole point of it. This is the whole purpose of it. This is real teaching. Okay. The notion that the teacher comes in with love, everyone just, oh, this is wonderful. So, this is not so. This is not so. I mean, look at the devotees of Anandamayi Maharshi, or Sri Sri Anandamayi. They always look very troubled, most of them. Because she was such good news. And they said, I can't, this is too much good news. You're killing me. This is so troublesome. I can't seem to fixate you. I'm trying to fixate you. I can't seem to fixate you. And they were very troubled. But this is good. This is great. So it's not about fixating on happiness. No, don't fixate on no fixation. No fixation on no fixation is really where it's at. Otherwise, you're spinning your wheels and you'll get pulled down again. You're still dreaming, and the dream will pull you down again, because you say, well, how do I be a good... Everyone's still bothered, you know, so how do I be a good teacher? Then how could I fixate, have a good fixation and... You know, you're still dreaming, still dreaming. I had a dream. I got a nightmare. Don't have a dream. So, what I've been trying to do here is to help the Dharma princes and princesses recover that, you know, status. You come into this world, you lose that status. You say, okay, this is my purpose. I'm coming in here to help. And what happens is you fall into this trap. We fall into this trap. So the way to recover is to be troubled by the great good news. One of the ways is to say, oh, a Dharma prince is here, a Dharma princess is here. That's like very troublesome, isn't it? Like, oh my gosh, I'm supposed to be one too. And I'm not, you know, because I can contrast now, I see. I'm not, and that you have to be troubled by that, but positively troubled. You say, oh great, this is fabulous, I can do it. Somebody knows, you know. Somebody's aware of how to, you know, get back to that helpfulness, genuine helpfulness. But you say, wow, I can do it. That's very troublesome. So you have to flip the script in this way. And the discipline is, I'm so troubled. So you're actually more troubled than before, but in a positive way. So you have to take on this ordeal. Because you're thinking, well, I just, you know, try to be nice and help people. I've got a little niche here. I set up shop and I'm not too troubled. But, well, actually... the ineffectiveness of that is going to trouble you greatly, okay, because it doesn't work, and the world is going to become very nasty as it expands its fixation and it, more to fixate on. You know, this is what's happening. Eventually, this is going to get to you. I'm talking to the Dharma King, Dharma princes and princesses here, right? Those are the ones watching the videos, right? This is going to be... eventually it's going to get you big time, and that's going to be really soon. And so the only ones that have helped me really most is the Dharma kings and queens, and also the viewers here, the Dharma princess and princesses who have fallen. You know, we fall, we have to realize that. But the rest of the world, but even the ones who have fallen, they don't want to help too much because they say, this is going to really trouble me. You know, if someone succeeds, this will really trouble me. Well, that's true, it will. But in a positive way. So you embrace that troublesomeness and say, okay, this is the way. Good, great. And so inside you say, there really is a way. And I'm seeing it. Wow. But when you see it, then that kind of freaks you out a little bit. Nothing freaks us out as much as success, seeing that. Wow. No food this morning. I'm struggling too. You know, this is intense for me. Very intense, of course. I was wiped out yesterday, Friday, long work week. I was exhausted, and I was facing some long commute. I said, I don't think I can make it, so I had to have a mocha frappuccino, which I find is less troublesome than a Coca-Cola. It kept me awake, but I'm, you know, experiencing some repercussions of it. I was able to sleep fine, but This shows that I'm struggling too, really. This is very intense. These dreams I'm having, these nightmares are horrible, and but you know I'm bouncing back from it, and trying to get into my role. But I'm exhausted. I mean I'm stressed out. No question about it. I think we all are. So I need to get this perspective. I'm working on this perspective and getting into it, have been for a long time. So the key is we realize that trouble's coming. This expansion of fixation is really expansion of paranoia too, isn't it? Because with more stuff to die, there's also more realization that it doesn't work, right? You see how it's like a shadow. There's more shadow. The more things there are, the more shadows are being cast, right? More fixation. So it seems, absurdity says, well, this is the way, but at the same time, there's more potential to lose the fixations and find out they don't work. That's the paranoia inside, the absurdity. It's always intrinsically there. So it's a double-edged sword. It's always a double-edged sword. Duality, you know, is terrible. The dream of duality is terrible. We keep fixating more and more and more, and yet it seems like our paranoia is still, it's like seems to be coming closer and closer, like, oh my God, you know, it's terrible. So if you see it this way, they say, oh, I'd rather be troubled by the good news, which gets less and less and less troublesome, rather than this other, which on the surface seems to be full of hope, but it actually gets worse and worse and worse and worse. And we throw in severe control systems then to make sure the death is, this death factory is more controlled. Yeah. Spreading death throughout the universe is what that absurdity is all about, isn't it? Spreading fixation throughout the universe and then dissolving the fixation to say, you see, the threat is gone. That threat is, I defeated that threat. You know, life didn't get to me. I defeated it. I defeated life. we're projecting the notion of life onto all the stuff, and then we kill it, and we say, I defeated that threat to my non-beingness. Yeah, absurdity doesn't like all this so-called this fixation it calls life. It's not really life at all. It in terms of fixation, it bakes all the stuff to kill it, to get rid of it. So it can feel powerful, more powerful. It got rid of this threat to non-being. So it labels all these fixations as life, and that kills them. Kill, you know, get dissolves. Dissolves it, and then puts it in the ground. They say, "Here lies a defeated life. Here lies defeated life, and I defeated it." And so now it's expanding. So it wants to, you know, expand to other planets and find ways to put life on those planets' fixations, and so that they can die there too. And wants death to be everywhere. More death, is what absurdity is always after. But it's always threatened about, still feels threatened. It's just like it's never enough. I need more. And when it's gone, this paranoia is still there. So I got to make sure I get some more. It just keeps getting, you know, the paranoia keeps roaring back like a tsunami. We just keep creating bigger and bigger tsunamis of paranoia. So it's a lot better to embrace the ordeal of being troubled with good news. It's a lot better. It's a lot easier. So this is the choice. I mean, it's what is the name? I can't remember that. There's a term for, like, you have two bad choices in hangman's choice, or there's some term for it. You have to choose one or the other. You have to choose one or the other. You're going to be troubled one way or the other. So pick your trouble. Pick your trouble. Commit to your trouble. Otherwise, you'll go with the status quo, which is dreaming, absurdity, death, all this stuff. Because that's where we're fixing. That's where we're stuck, right? So if you don't commit to the court of the Dharma King, then you're going to go with the court of the absurdist queen. You might say, yoga girl, they're the ones who are large and in charge right now, because they're the ones saying, no trouble, no trouble at all. You know, the motto, what's the motto of all the techies and the younger people? No problem, no problem, no problem, whatever it is, no problem. This is the thing, they say, there's no trouble, no problem, we're succeeding, we're succeeding, we're succeeding. That's their mantra. They're hoping for no trouble. Yeah, no, we know the way to no trouble. It's amazing. These tech people, the mindset of technology is, it's been consistent throughout the whole thing. It's a complete mindset that, you know, that by expanding fixation, they're going to get rid of trouble. Problems, no problem. They do this software company, this idea, and people say, well, what about? I think they're talking about, I heard some, they're talking about, like, driverless cars. They'll get shifting everybody over to driverless cars, and we'll get rid of the problem there. And then someone says, well, you know, what about this issue and this issue? I mean, they're raising these immense problems. And the answer to the techie says, no, it's really not, that's really not much of a problem at all. Easy solution. It's always an easy solution for them. And don't get conned by this. It's a massive con game they're engaging in. Absolutely it is. It's almost like a robotic thing. They're just programmed, saying, no trouble, no trouble. Just keep expanding fixation. They say, eventually, the trouble will disappear. No, it won't. It'll get worse. Paranoia will get worse, actually. And we're about to find out just how bad it gets here. So you got to see yourself as a Dharma prince or a Dharma princess, okay? Now, the Dharma king or queen is already beyond abidance and non-abidance, you might say. There's no fixation on no fixation. For them, there's no fixation on no fixation whatsoever, okay? That's the ultimate. That's our true nature. But not only that, but there's no temptation on their part to ever even fixate on no fixation. So you could say they're beyond the beyond. We could say that. What's the way I say it? It's beyond the beyond. And there's no way we can reflect this. Okay, so we're not aiming for that. That can't be an aim. Okay? It can't be an aim. Because there's nothing to aim at, actually. So because we're so accustomed to being troubled, we have to have an aim. Okay, to get free of that trouble, right? So Dharma prince or princess is an aim we can have. We can have that as an aim. To work towards that role of helping others be troubled with the good news, right? This is sort of the aim. We can have that. So it is a kind of aim we can have. So in other words, don't aim too high, because you're aiming at nothing then. And this is because of our continuity issue. We can't do that. You just have to immediately, you know, toga, leap into that just directly. This, but it's like the leap of no leap, you know. And that is simply, I know that a lot of people like to play intellectually with this concept, and it makes them think that they're free of trouble, potentially, you know. But this is just outsmarting oneself. Okay, that's all it is. There's a saying in Buddhism. A lot of people in Buddhism do that. Now, I have an advantage because I am not a Buddhist. I don't come from the tradition of Buddhism. You see, so I'm not caught up in that, in all this gamesmanship, which Buddhists tend to get caught up in. As someone said, there's nobody asks more questions than Buddhists. They just, but what about this? And they keep intellectually playing with this because they're aiming too high. They're aiming too high. They're aiming at no aim. This is ridiculous. I mean, this is not pragmatic. And now, so Jesus helps, is vastly helpful for Buddhists, to tell you the truth. For Buddhists, I come from a background of listening to Jesus and A Course in Miracles. Of Jesus points out very clearly, you cannot make that leap pragmatically. He says, forget about it. No. Because it's no leap at all. It's the leap of no leap. And this is, it's not sudden enlightenment. It's beyond that. And it's beyond, there's no one to be enlightened. There's no way to reflect what we are at all. And so we're so accustomed to be reflecting, to be fixating, to be troubled. This is all the massive, severe continuity problem we have. And there, he said that pragmatically, says there's no way you can just, you know, be finished with that like that. Not pragmatically, you cannot. So he tells us, don't try to aim too high. He says, forget about it. This is a great teaching of Jesus. Very pragmatic. But those who are, who don't want to be troubled by the good news, end up trying to intellectualize and get it conceptually and do this non-dual spiel, thinking that, you know, if I just can say, you know, there's no one there to be, you know, whatever, that's it. That's it. This is the big mistake. This is what I've seen in the world. This is what we happens. Because we say, well, I don't want to be troubled. Well, guess what? We're going to be troubled for a while. And they think, well, how can I teach? I don't want to trouble people. Well, you're going to trouble people with your teaching, with being a Dharma prince or princess. Absolutely. But you have to tell them that this is what you have to do. You can't just make an intellectual structure of no fixation upon no fixation, because you're still fixating on, there's still a fixator on that. There's still subjectiveness there. You can't do it that way. It's just a dead end. And so then I'm saying the trouble is you want to be an effective teacher, and you've gotten conned into thinking that you're an ineffective teacher because you're troubling people. This is, see, that's a con, because we didn't realize the continuity fear. We didn't realize how severe it is. Okay, this is what this is the central point of my mission here, you might say. One of the central points of it. There he is. We underestimate the intensity of the continuity fear, how severe it is. It is a exceedingly severe problem. And in our haste to help people avoid this tsunami of paranoia, we say, well, that takes too long then. It takes too long. And then we try to find some shortcut, which ends up just cleverness, and we outsmarted ourselves, thinking that we could just strategize around it through intellectualisms. It doesn't work. So we have to take a longer term viewpoint, the big picture. Someone has to mind the store, the long-term viewpoint store. Someone has to be minding that store. So I'm just minding that store. And when we get in too much of a hurry, we underestimate the severity of the continuity fear, and then that traps us. That traps us. And then we get pulled into just being an intellectual figurehead, really. And we lose our Dharma princess status. We don't have it anymore. And then we say, well, you don't need that. you just leap. No, you cannot. Because we thought, well, I'm not being effective in that way. So how do I be effective? Yes, we are being effective. There is a way to be effective, but people are troubled by it. And we say, well, see, oh, that's not being effective. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I've been very troubled by Jesus, Sri Sri Anandamayi, Dharma Maharshi, Longchenpa. They're very troublesome to me. They're very troublesome because they bring such good news. And I was like, that's terrible. Nobody will get that. Nobody can understand. What are you talking about? I'm so troubled by it. How can I teach that? That's troublesome. And thank God for Jesus pointing out the continuity fear, because I had lost sight of that. I just assumed that it's there must be some other way to teach, because this is too severe. It is just really severe. We're so used to being troubled, we can't just drop being troubled directly. Continuity fear, precludes that for us. So again, we have to remain troubled, but we change what we're troubled by. So I wasn't getting the help I needed from those in this world. I had to go to the great Dharma kings and queens and be troubled by what they said, because most of the teachings in this world and the teachers in this world, they don't trouble you enough. Not really. They don't point out the severity of the continuity fear appropriately. They're not adamant enough. So it wasn't helpful enough for me. I had to go to the real heavyweights. And that was very troublesome. They were very troublesome. So it was very humbling. Yeah, very humbling. I said, I'm supposed to be a Dharma prince, but I'm like just getting clobbered by this. I got no confidence. I'm so troubled. But we have to wake up to what a Dharma prince or princess really is. And then it's a role. So how do you play the role? We thought, oh, this role isn't effective. We got fooled. We got fooled. Because the intensity of the trouble coming here, there's a feeling like you got to do it fast. And you say, well, we got to get people free of this feeling of trouble. Well, there was time to do it if we had just focused on the continuity fear. And so, but we now understand how just paranoia fixates and expands. So this goes on. It goes on. So the long-term viewpoint is we still are able to help out. Always will be. But we don't want to get pulled down by this trick. It's a trick. It's the way paranoia, absurdity, is trying to trick itself in into thinking that, well, this is it. No, this is never it. It's never it. This fixed dream of fixation, it just keeps dreaming it. It keeps dreaming it. So it's a nasty trap, and many, we've gotten pulled down into this trap. But the easy answer is just get into the court of the Dharma King or Queen. Get in the court of the Dharma King here. And we might say, well, I don't want anyone to know I got pulled down. Okay, come on, getting pulled down is what happens here. It's what happens. I got terribly pulled down. And then we think, well, I should be able to easily get out of that. No, this continuity fear is very severe. And so we're humiliated. Well, it should be easy for me. Well, it is. But that's the problem. We're so used to being troubled. If it's easy, we're not being troubled, right? So our compassion, our desire, compassion to help got used against us, you know. It got flipped on us. There's nothing more dangerous than too much compassion, too much heart. That's the worst. That has to be balanced with the head, the heart and the head balance, so to speak. It really means just compassion and skillful means. This skillful means has to have the upper hand in this situation, in turn, really. You have to know what's going on. Really be disciplined that way. You cannot let the heart lead compassion. Take the lead. You're going to get clobbered. Because real compassion is what? Skillful means, knowing what you're doing. That's real compassion. The other is really misadventure. Misadventure. It's an ego trip, actually. The ego puts you on a wonderful ego trip of compassion. But nothing gets helped. Not really helping, just making it worse. So it's not really compassion, actually. So there are lots of compassionate teachers teaching me I'm compassionate. This is making it worse, really. It's not, it's interfering, it's getting in the way of it's giving a wrong impression of everything. That somehow you don't have to go through the ordeal of being troubled by good news. This is false. I mean, these have those who have fallen down, not being humble, not admitting that they fall into this trap, are trying to aim too high and tell that there's a way you don't have to be troubled at all by the ordeal of being troubled by good news, and it gives a wrong impression to everybody. Then, so they're trying to keep thinking that they're still teachers. They're not. They lost their teaching function, so to speak. Their dharma prince and princess status. They lost that status, and they're still pretending they didn't. And then trying to teach falsely by saying that there's just an easy way. You don't have to trouble at all. That's not true. It's not true at all. And that gives a wrong impression of what teaching is all about. And so when someone comes along with right teaching, a Dharma prince or princess, people look at them and say, oh, you don't really know what you're talking about. These other teachers, they can get me there without any trouble. No, what happens is you get caught up in this belief of expanding fixation, thinking that'll get rid of your paranoia. What it really does is just makes the paranoia even worse. You kick the can of paranoia down the road a little bit, but it comes back fast. I mean, how do you get rid of your shadow? When you're casting when you have fixation, you're casting a shadow of paranoia, really. And so the way is for repentance. Now really, the ones who are able to repent best of all are the Dharma king, princess and princesses who have fallen, like the apostles of Jesus. They forgot what their mission was, and then he helped them remember. He says, you got to repent. You got to repent. You got to realize that this teaching of this ego trip that you've been on, of compassion, that's an ego trip. It's an ego trip. You've got to tell people the right way, which is this ordeal of being troubled by good news. It's an ordeal. It's an ordeal. Full stop in the wow. It's an ordeal. It's like running a marathon. But when you finish, it's like, wow, I did it. How fabulous. You know, how absolutely fabulous. But while you're ready, it says, hey, this isn't easy. It's not easy. There's no easy enlightenment, really, from our standpoint. Because, again, ultimately, if you point to the ultimate, there's nothing to point to. So you can't say it's easy or not easy at all. So by saying easy enlightenment, this is falsity. Really, it really is. It's falsity. You should say there's only tough enlightenment, really. There's only difficult. There's only troublesome enlightenment. That's true. There's only troublesome enlightenment. It's going, the ordeal will trouble you. Because with the wow. Because seeing that there's no trouble at all, inherently, and never has been, is wow. You know, what's going to happen to my future? What's going to happen to everything? What's going to happen? You know, it's just like the ramifications reverberate. It's the reverberation of ramifications and expectations, reverberation of expectations. And so you might think, at first you think, oh, I'm free, this is great, and then, but the deep reverberations, become aware of that. So don't fixate on being free. This is the mistake that these easy enlightenment teachers make. They're not really Dharma princes and princesses, in my opinion, okay? I'm stating my viewpoint here. Sure, you can get a glimpse of all this. But then they want you to fixate on it. Or they say, don't fixate. But they want you to fixate on not fixating. This doesn't work. It doesn't work. And we wonder why. How come we don't have these great teachers? Well, it doesn't work that way. What we should be doing is say, okay, full stop on the wow. You glimpse it, you see, okay, full stop on the wow. Prepare yourself, because the backlash is coming. The backlash, the reverberations, oh my gosh. Yeah, I can feel it right now. I'm talking about this, you know, shaking and trembling. I mean, this is an ordeal. You know, it's like, oh my gosh. What am I saying? You know, what did I do? What did I just see? Oh, but what about the universe? What about the world? What about people? What about bodies? What about things? What about fixations? What about no fixations? What about the, you know? So the deep familiarity we've had with trouble and fixation and paranoia and all, and trying to fix and heal and all this stuff for so long, and the whole notion of expanding all of this. All these are our expectations for the future. Everything just is gone. It doesn't even collapse. It's like, it's as if it was never there, without a trace. Now, can you just abide in that continuously for evermore? Or not even abide it? It's just effortless. It's even no fixation on abidance, because that's ultimately that's Buddha mind, Christ mind. That is our true nature. Of course, we're not going to do that right off. That, you know, and so we're going to end up then either fixating on no fixation, or we're going to go into full stop in the wowness, which, and that is the path ultimately to being a Dharma king or queen. You know, The Dharma prince and Dharma princess, all they're on the path to being a Dharma king and a Dharma queen. They really are. Okay? We can say we really are. So you, the way to do that is not to fixate on no fixation. That won't do it at all. It's to full stop in the wow. So I say, okay, here comes the backlash, but I'm not going to fixate on any success or non-success. I'm just no fixate. I'm going to just sit here and don't do anything. Did I glimpse it? I'm not saying I glimpsed it. Did I not glimpse it? I'm not saying that. I don't have a position. I don't really have a position one way or the other at all. On either success or not success or enlightenment or no enlightenment or just wow. The only position I have is just wow, which is a non-position, right? You can, and so you accept this non-position consciously of just wow. So it's a very non-fixated non-position, you might say. And then you're able to trouble others to do this also, and that you are a Dharma prince or princess at that point, really. Because you're advising them correctly. You're giving the right advice to becoming ultimately a Dharma king or Dharma queen, which is beyond anything that we can aim at all, actually. There's no aim. Nothing to aim at. Longchenpa is a Dharma king. Jesus is a Dharma king. You see, this is where they're coming from. Cleared up. The cloudiness cleared up. It's a gorgeous day today. This is where they're coming from. How are we doing here? I'm okay. Which seems to be they're coming from nowhere at all. So we are making clear differentiation here. So the wow is very strong about this. It is. It's been an extraordinary hour here that we've spent. So you don't fixate on a Dharma prince or Dharma princess. You practice full stop in the wow. As you hear this, and you say, oh my gosh, I'm seeing it now. I'm seeing how I was trapped. I see how to get out. Wow. And what do you do? Do you fixate on that? No. Wow. We full stop in the wow. I'm not trying to reflect anything. Just be non-reflective. But don't fixate on being non-reflective either, neither advancing nor retreating. Don't take pride in being non-reflective. Don't fixate on being non-reflective, because you say this too will wear off. So just full stop in the wow, and we let it just naturally evaporate. Whatever's evaporating, we're patient, and we don't try to fixate on what's evaporating or not evaporating. So it's a patience. This is the ordeal. It's just this patience. You see, it takes a while. Just let it, whatever will be with it, this. Okay, we saw it. Okay, now let that seeing do its work. And we're not going to anticipate, project, plan, expect. This is difficult, isn't it? It's an ordeal. It's full stop in the wow. So I did a little trail running. Yes. Okay, I can still do that. You know, my feet are hurting this morning. Yeah. But is that what I really want to do? I want to fixate on trail running? Now, we're shifting gears. As we allow this wow to just, you know, cool, evaporate to take place. We're still in the wow here. We cool down. We just allow this cool down to take place. So we have a little shop talk here, chit chat. physicality of this world's culture now. Something half the world's under 35 or 33 or something. I mean, more people are young than not here. It's unprecedented, the amount of young people in the world. And young people tend to be quite physical, you know, vigorous physical. So there's this culture of physicality is now just incredibly intense, especially in the Silicon Valley, because this is where all the tech people are, and they're all young. Almost all of them. So there's this massive youth culture here. But it's all over the world, really, right? This youth culture. And if you're old here, you feel like tremendously pressured by this youth culture of physicality. And the way that people drive is an expression of their mindset, isn't it? You can always tell the personality of a driver. I mean, the person is the way they drive, just overall. You know, you get the gist of it, right? Because people feel they're insulated from the world and they're in a car, so they don't, their guard isn't up so much, and the way they drive, that's their personality, actually. It's revealed. And here, they drive really fast and physical. Way too fast. And aggressive. It's aggressive physicality. It's a physicality. And so I'm driving, wherever I drive, I'm on these mountain roads yesterday. Very windy and curvy. I mean, you got to pay attention to what you're doing. I mean, it was really rough. I did a massive amount of this, wow, very, very tough, dangerous roads. And everybody was just getting on my tail and pressuring me. I said, hey, folks, I'm already going too fast here. I'm maxing out my speed. And you're like saying, you know, this isn't fast enough. And I say, look, sure, you want to go faster, but it's not safe. So I'm trying to teach them a lesson. Say, look, can you not just cool it a little bit here? No. So I had to keep pulling off the side of the road and let these cars go by. It was crazy. And then you're pressured to speed up, but it's not safe. It really isn't. I mean, there's these motorcycles. I mean, there are cars. I'm going down this one very, very, very dangerous windy road downhill, and there are these cars going uphill, and they're going over the line, and they're cutting corners, these motorcycles. They almost lost it, almost, you know, could have been crashed into me. I mean, they're just speeding. They can't slow down. It is insane. They can't slow down. So I want to tell you, this physical culture, they can't slow down. They're not able to. They freak out if someone's trying to slow. They can't slow down. And so stop trying to slow them down. They're not going to. You know, they're not going to slow down. This is something we got to get through. We're trying to help them slow down, okay? And so I'm there on the road, and I'm like, I'm trying, you know, going slow. So I'm not going to let you by. And there's a whole line of cars behind me. Not just one. They're all going fast, too fast. And at some point, it gets to you, because I'm holding up, you know, 15 cars, and they're all like, directing their hatred towards me. I say, what the heck? Pull over, let them go by. Because they're not getting it. They don't get it. This teaching is lost on them. And we just have to understand that this generation, this situation, is 3 or 4 generations now of youth culture that have built up this physicality. And you're not going to get through to them. Just not. I've tried my very best to do so. The only ones you get through to are the Dharma princes and princesses who have fallen, which almost inevitably happens here, especially now. But just imagine how great it is when you recover your status here, even under these circumstances. You know, wow, talk about trial by fire. It's a great opportunity, because it's you know, not recovering, this is terrible. They're going to be used by the yoga girls as figureheads. Yoga girl culture, this physical youth yoga girl culture, goddess culture. These aggressive, physical, egotists love the mother goddess because she's like a drug that cools them down a little bit, but not too much, so then they can keep being physical. You see, that's the thing. That's how they are. Whereas the Dharma kings and queens, you have to actually practice being troubled by truth, great good news, and then full stop in the wow. You have to slow down. You have to handle the wow. They want it like a drug, like they want to be drugged by the goddess. It's an idol. She gives them a hit, you know, of a hit of bliss, and then boom, they're back, their physicality. They don't realize that this is a discipline that leads to, you know, Buddha mind, or actually no fixation at all. They think they can keep their fixation, but take a little break from it, yeah, or cool down a little bit. The goddess helps them mellow out a little bit, and then boom, back to their physicality. So this is what happens in a youth culture. And we're not just in a youth culture, we're in like fourth generation youth culture now. And so this has become institutionalized in the mindset of the world now. And the way of maturity is seen as folly. We don't need it. We can keep expanding fixation. And of course, the goddess being a mother principle means bodies, more things to fixate on. So they're worshiping her, saying, you're going to help us project more threat, fixations and project threat on that, and then get rid of this paranoia. So they're into worshiping the mother goddess, the principle of expanding thingness, fixationness. And that reassures them. She reassures them. They go worship her idol, and they feel more physical. She helps them feel even more physical, more active, you know. Where this is so, you know, the Holy Spirit, Dharma kings and queens, there's no body there present so much. It's less and less and less fixation, more and more abstraction. That freaks them out. No, they say, no. So they can't slow down. They cannot. I was like trying to, okay, let me get some separation. Let me go faster. And I was like, ooh, you're like, wow. And these trucks and cars and stuff, they're going around turns, and they're almost losing it. And this is just like, just the standard way everybody's driving. They're right on the edge of crashing, essentially. They really are. And we should realize the world's right on the edge of a big crash, a big tsunami. They can't slow down, folks. Okay, they cannot. Because they're being driven by paranoia and the belief that by expanding fixation, they're free of paranoia. So for them, there's no road back except to go faster. That's it. Everything in the Silicon Valley here is go faster. In your computer, faster, faster, faster. They're fixated on going faster. They don't know how to slow down. And it'll be quite some time before they slow down. They're going to have to go through some nasty, brutal experiencings before they... Something in their mind says, you know what, you know, I just, please, is there any help for me? I just can't seem to slow down. This is horrible. Yeah, that's where they're headed. They can't slow down. They're being driven like by a demon and being attracted by the mother goddess of, oh, you know, the cosmos is so welcoming, so inviting to me, more fixation. This is their religion, you know, it's terrible. So it was a good experience for me yesterday. Nobody, very rarely do I get anyone who gets it, and I'm going at a reasonable pace, and they realize, oh, wait a minute, I'm going too fast, and then they back off and give me some space. Very rarely does that happen now. Whereas, for me, if I'm going too fast, and someone's going slow, I say, hey, wait a minute. Am I going too fast? Oh, yeah, I am. Thank you. And I thank them. And then I back off and I give them space. So I'm not right on their bumper, pushing them to go faster. I don't want to give the impression that I want them to go faster. So I back off and I say, thank you. I'll just convoy with you. So this is a whole different mentality. You don't see that here. This is the mentality of the true path. This is following the Dharma prince or princess. They're helping you slow down on your path of fixation. They're helping you slow down until you back off and say, thank you. So let me full stop in the wow now. But this is seen in the world now. These are just obstructionists. These people are standing in the way of progress. Right? This is what they say. They're so absurd, really. The world is so absurd. So trying to get people to genuinely slow down as the path itself and embrace the trouble of that is a lost cause among the youth here of this world. It's always been somewhat of a lost cause among the youth, just by the nature of youthfulness, is to feel like I can go fast, because they come into the world to try to expand fixation, so they think this is a great time to do it. But when there's a more spiritual culture, this is not so true. I mean, look at Tibetan Buddhism, the Tulku traditions, and they get it. They start from the get-go of people come and say, thank you so much for helping me slow down. You know, thank you so much for helping me, troubling me with great good news. And they praise the children for being calm and relaxed. And so the children there, the ones who are trained in this way, they're not like our youth, you know, here of go, 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 go. They can sit through ceremonies that last days, these children, without getting agitated at all. It's extraordinary. People say, this is impossible. Where do they get this? Because people praise them for the role that they came to fulfill and say, we're so grateful that you're going to help us in this way. You're here to help us like this. See? Fabulous culture. This is how it's supposed to be. Whereas here, they say, oh, you're here to help us speed up. Throw your energy and youth into help speeding up so we can expand our fixations. More and more and more life to die. We need more life to die. Yeah, that's all it is. Is we're expanding death, really, is all we're trying to do here in the world. This is what the world is aiming for. And what we're saying is we don't need any death at all. And I'm like, what? Paradise jumps up. I'm so troubled by that. Yeah, be troubled by that. We don't need death at all. So I've tried to trouble everyone here in the world by these videos, by the great good news. We don't need any death at all. We don't need to dream at all. But you don't fixate on a person, a Dharma king or a Dharma queen or a Dharma prince or a Dharma princess. You practice. You don't fixate. You practice. There's etiquette, there's decorum. There's decorum, but not fixation. So it's not guru fixation. Even in Tibet, they seem to be so guru fixated, but really, what does the guru tell them? Practice. So they're really focused on practice. And they're practicing, you know, so. But it's not guru worship. It's not guru fixation. But that's a cultural, I mean, the cultural thing. Here, we're so obsessed with fixation, we can't imagine non-fixation. But what we have to do is turn our being troubled. We're being troubled by no fixation, and then full stop. And wow, we have to practice. So as we're non-fixating, we're troubled by this. And then the guru is someone who helps us practice. Really, is what the guru does. Guru, most gurus would be Dharma kings or Dharma princess, or Dharma princesses, really. And occasionally, Dharma kings and queens come here. They actually come as a body. They come to help out, but oftentimes they help out subtly. They're not in a body. The help I've gotten have been from unembodied Dharma kings and queens, not in a body here. As Ramana says, the guru is never a body in the first place. The guru has got nothing to do with the body. So how can you say when the body dies, the guru's no more? The guru never was the body. So what does that have to do with the guru? He says, I'm still here helping you even more, he says. The guru doesn't die when the body dies. The body is just this ridiculous attempt on absurdity to get rid of paranoia by fixating belief there's some form. There's actually no real form there at all. It's just a belief. But it's a belief so we can project threat onto that and then have the fixation dissolve and then claim the threat's dissolved. That's all it is. The body is just light. It's just light. It's just a play of light, really. That's all it is. Just a play of light. It's just inherent spaciousness. There's no fixation of inherent spaciousness. You can't fixate pure spaciousness at all. This is just ornamentations. You know, this is just... But anyway. Starting to warm up a little bit here. I think I was a little bit optimistic about, you know, it's going to be a nice warm California day, but it's chilly in the morning still, a little bit chilly. So it was a little bit cold here. Let me move about for just one moment here. Okay, very great. And this brings me to the issue that I want to also talk about, is the physicality of everything. Okay, this is a fact. It is a fact. They can't slow down. They cannot slow down. And very, 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 very physically oriented culture in the world now. It's mind-blowing. I just am astonished by it. But when I was young, you know, the pressure here to be physical so strong, and people are just like doing radical stuff, mountain biking through these incredible trails and running and just pushing themselves. I mean, it's so physical. So it's very intimidating. It can be very intimidating if you're into contemplation, you're into full stop in the wow, being troubled by truth, where you're just sitting doing nothing, you're practicing doing nothing. You feel like the world's passing you by, like you're out of touch with the world, and the pressure to be physical, you feel like it can be very intimidating, very intimidating. And so what I've done is kind of try to build up my physicality to the point where I can kind of say, well, you can't really push me around. I mean, if I had to trail run, I could trail run. You know, I've done that before. If I had to hike, I could hike. I'm not so non-physical that I seem to be an aberration. Like, oh, something really wrong with you. You know, like you're really out of it. This is an insidious pressure in the world right now. Very insidious pressure. And I'm aware of it, I became aware of it. I was looking at these shoes and boots, and I couldn't believe it. I mean, in the comments of people, they are so geared up. They're so geeked out on gear. And the right, these shoes, and they're just so into every little aspect and of these shoes and the weight and the materials and what they're for. And they're very, very adept at physicality, you know, and the gear of physicality. And I just, like, wow. Back in my day, you get a pair of tennis shoes and you run in tennis shoes. You get a high pair of hiking boots, you hike. But now there's like, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of options, and everybody is very knowledgeable, like, of what they're into, what you're into, from every angle. The thingness, you know, the ability, the fixation, more things to fixate upon. I just look like a bicyclist. I mean, I just put on a, used to just, you know, pair of shorts. I didn't have no bike outfit at all. Just a pair of shorts. Whatever I was wearing was my bike outfit. Didn't even wear a helmet back then. But, I mean, nowadays, the bikers are just, every single biker you see, 99.9% are just completely geared out in every which manner possible. You know, they just, you know, almost rarely do you see anyone on a bike anymore who's just like, you know, wearing a sweatshirt and a pair of blue jeans and some tennis shoes. And just, And the women, same thing. The women are just as geared up as the men. You see so many women biking, bicycling. Just with the men, it's the same thing. They're just as physical. They're going on the same rides, everything. And they're just totally geared out. And it's just, it's become this, you know, it's like, what? And it's this way, everything is this way now. And it's just astonishing because I don't do any of this stuff. It's easy just to, you know, it all passes me by. But the pressure is on, is so severe that I don't want to feel like I'm an aberration. Or I don't want to feel like I'm really, you know, missing something. So if I'm in shape, I can say, well, I could do that if I could do that. I just ran like a little while on a trail, and I said, okay, I can do this. I don't need to. But just by saying I can do it and doing a little bit of it, I said, I'm not really interested. I could do it, but I got something better to do. So this kind of keeps you, pushes back. It pushes back. Say, yeah, I could do it. Sure, I could do it. I'm in good enough shape. I could do that. But I got something way better to do. Because this full stop in the wow really is also, there's an intensity to it that's even more than physicality, actually, which is true. This is more intense than taking a mountain bike ride. It's a higher intensity. It's not a physical intensity. It's a wow intensity. It's a spiritual wow. Not a physical wow, but a spiritual wow. Yeah. And it's a way higher, bigger, wider intensity than any physicality could ever be. So the physicality, that stuff is just child's play. It's a play of children. And it's juvenile. We live in an extremely juvenile culture right now, actually. Incredibly superficial and juvenile. But you know how juveniles are. They think they're so cool. We have to remind them they're not so cool. But the problem is there's too many of them now. And you know how juveniles get in gangs? Well, we live in a gang culture of juvenile gangs. And I don't mean just the criminal gangs. I mean the absurdist, paranoid gangs of juvenile, egoic, ego-tripping juvenile culture. They're ganging up by social media, by this and this and this. They're very much ganging up of insisting that what they're doing is this is where it's at, and no, there's nowhere else where it's at. And you are doing this full stop. And the West says you're idiots. You're just like, you're complete morons, and you shouldn't exist. You know how juveniles can be nasty? They absolutely, juvenile culture is very nasty, very gangish, which is why people, you know, are worshiping gang culture. So cool. I mean, you see these like people. Is listening to gang, you know, music, gangster music, rap music. A lot of it's very gangster oriented. But, you know, I hear it. It's like, and they think, oh, I'm so cool. I'm so cool. I'm so cool. It's very gangsterish, and you know, we're worshiping lawlessness, which is juveniles. Juveniles love to be feel like we're lawless. We're beyond that. You know, we're and this is the whole culture is becoming juvenile. So it's all becoming gangish, which is why gangs are taking over the world. This, and police are seen as the enemy. You know, juveniles hate the police. They see the police as the enemy. Now, I'm shocked by elder people, their attitudes towards the police, very juvenile attitudes. Now, when I'm a juvenile, when we're juveniles, sure, we're doing stuff that's very edgy, and the police are the enemy because we don't want the parents. Our parents are the enemy. The police are the enemy. We don't want to get caught. We don't want to get caught, right? And so, I hate those guys. They're going to catch me and punish me or something. Really, what they do is they, hey, you know, knock it off. Stop you know, be careful, be more careful. You might be endangering people. Don't be such a knucklehead. And so they have a negative attitude towards law enforcement, parents, law enforcement, authority figures. When you mature, then you realize, oh, wow, yeah, I was being real edgy and kind of stupid and endangering myself and others, and I get it. It's not good for me. I'm out of it now. I've matured. And then you have a much more positive viewpoint towards law enforcement. So in the more mature cultures, there's not a problem with the police. The police are loved and respected. Thank you for protecting and serving. There's not trouble like that. But in this youth culture, this juvenile, immature juvenile culture we have now, the police are like the enemy. Authority figures are the enemy. And I'm shocked by older people now who have been sucked into this juvenile culture. They say, oh, the police are these pigs. They're terrible. They're horrible. They're awful. I hate the police. I hate law enforcement. They're like, what? It's like, uh-oh, this is a very juvenile attitude. Now, even some of the Dharma princes and princesses that have gotten trapped and fallen asleep or dreaming feel that way because they're trying to figure out, how can I lead these juvenile culture? How can I help them? And the juvenile culture insists, well, you've got to, recognize how cool we are. The police are terrible. So they end up, because they're trying to help out of compassion, they're over-identifying with it. They're not giving the right tough love, which is necessary. Which is be troubled by the good news. That's tough love, but that's what works. And so not realizing how severe the continuity problem is, they think that what they're doing is the only way of non-tough love and identifying and agreeing with the juvenile culture. Because they think, no, all these authority figures, they don't get it. There's an easier way. But what happened was, again, we underestimated the severity of the continuity problem, and it got us. It got us. Again. It's almost impossible to overestimate it. It's so severe. So you just have to use tough love. There's no two ways about it. There isn't. There's no other way. And then, of course, the juveniles will hate you. Oh, you're an authority figure. You're bad. You're an idiot. We have a smarter way. We're smarter than you. Then, you think, oh, I'm not helping them. Well, take the long-term viewpoint. You'll be helpful at some point. You have to maintain your capacity so you can help. If you don't have capacity, for sure you won't be able to help. So that's just foolish. So you regain your capacity and then see how helpful you can be. Maybe not so much of this juvenile culture. Yeah, right. But at least you're aware of that. Oh, okay. This is what we want to avoid. You want to avoid going down into juvenile culture. It's part of the... So you don't necessarily want to build up this high population in a world of more and more children. That's a bad thing, actually. You want more older people in a culture. And you want a lot of people not having children, actually, and not having so much children. So you have a lot of mature adults around. So the culture doesn't flip into a juvenile culture. So this is what's happened here. It's really bad. Very, very bad scenario. The idea that juveniles are so wise. No, they're not. They're idiots. Okay. Oh, we were juvenile. We look back at us an idiot. Why did I do these things? Stupid. Why did I try to prove myself that way? I wish I hadn't have, wasted the time that way. Wow, it wasn't much fun at all, actually. Being a juvenile, they're scared, so they try to overcompensate. I claim, no, we're awesome. They're scared. paranoid because they say, I wonder if my death is going to work this time. I wonder if all this dying is going to work. Maybe it won't work. And they feel that they're now threatening themselves, you know, their life threatening absurdity. And they're not really loved. And, you know, it's horrible coming into this fixation, this dream of fixation. Buying into this dream of fixation is horrible. So the adults in the room right now, they're under the gun. The adults in this world are under the gun. Most people have adopted a juvenile stance. Most. Of all ages now. It's just because the pressure is overwhelming, because absurdity is saying, hey, you know, we have to expand fixation. Whereas the adults say, no, we don't. We need to practice full stop and the wow. We need to repent. The adults in the room saying we need to repent. The juveniles are saying, no, we don't need to repent. We know the easy way, quick way. We're going to really push this through. Got to go faster. Repentance, that's slowing down. Now we got to go faster. So completely different viewpoints. The juvenile ways, we got to speed everything up. The adults' way is say, no, we need to slow everything down. We repent, slow down, full stop in the wow. Like, wow, I don't need any to project life at all. Life can't be really be projected at all. So I'm just imagining illusions, mirages. How can I project intrinsic spaciousness? How can that be actually projected? Is anything being projected? Not really, but we're imagining it is. Subject-object. We're just imagining subject-object, actually. It is not even there at all. And so when we see this, we say, okay, well, we'll have to trouble others with this great news. But it'll be very troublesome for them, and they have to be very disciplined, very patient. And meanwhile, the whole world seems to be on this real cool expansion, progression sort of thing. And we're thinking we're being left behind. Very, very difficult, isn't it, right now? So, also, looking cool. So I can be cool if I need to be. I can be juvenile if I need to be, but, you know. So I kind of like, I have my juvenile clothes on. I can be juvenile. But if you're too identified as the adult in the room, you're under fire, too much fire here. And part of being the adult in the room as well, you're out of shape, you're wearing old clothes, you don't look like a juvenile too much. So what I've done is I've tried to make myself look more like a juvenile, so it doesn't trouble people too strongly, you know, I don't get too much pushback. Or I can say, well, if I have to be, I could be juvenile too. So you kind of hedge your bets there. Is a pragmatic thing. It's a fire-breaking technique, actually. So I see my clothes are more like juvenile, like what I'd wear as a juvenile. Because the pressure is so severe here. You can get suicidal if you're the adult and you feel, you know, you're just so out of it and everyone hates you. And really, that's a problem. It's a problem. So we play the fool a little bit here, which is playing the juvenile a little bit. Play the fool. Oh yeah, I was up there. I did a little trail running, you know. Might even get some trail running shoes. I got some trail running shoes or some hiking shoes or whatever. I can, but right now I'm focusing on full stop on the wild. I got to get that working too, you know. So right now I'm working on the path, but later I might be juvenile. See, you reassure them. As I said, I went through this previous video, I went through this scenario in my mind between the queen of the yoga girls and Longchenpa, Dharma King. And she was demanding that Longchenpa surrender me, turn me over to her. And it went back and forth, and she kept trying to make different deals with him. Deal, okay, how about this deal? How about this deal? And ultimately, Longchenpa just said, look, I'm not going to turn him over to you right now, okay? But maybe later, you know, I'll reconsider as a possibility. I'm not closing the door on turning him over to you, but just not right now. This is how he adjudicated the situation. Very wise, huh? Now, when Longchenpa came to me in the dream, he was dressed in a juvenile costume of running shorts and a lifeguard shirt and tennis shoes. Yeah. So I think he was pointing out to me, hey, look, be in shape so that you can stay the juveniles. But I might join you later on. I'm not going to join you right now, but I might join you later on. See, you need to do this, to cut yourself some slack. Otherwise, you're going to think you got to just jump into no jump. And you can't. Like, you have to aim for no aim. You can't do it like that. Nobody can. No one can. Stop believing you can do it like that. You're just being driven into juvenility if you get caught in that trap. Instant enlightenment. You'll end up being... That's the yoga girl trap, okay? They got these teachers, yoga girl teachers, are teaching instant, quick enlightenment. And that just ends up pulling you into juvenility and into expanding death, actually. Thinking that you're being cool by doing it and giving everybody the answer. So, I've adopted a more juvenile look. So, I can say, I'm not going to do that right now, but I could do it. I might do it later. I'm not closing the door. It's possible I could do it later. But right now, I'm focusing on this right now. And they're kind of like, you really think you're telling me the truth? I say, well, look at me. I'm ready to go. You know, but not right now. I'm not going to. Sure, I could get into it. I'm not against it. You know, look, I'm not against that. I'm not out of it, so not so out of it. You don't need to be concerned. That interesting way of diffusing the pressure, isn't it? Now, before, I was trying the old man thing. Okay, I'm gonna be the adult. I'm gonna look like the adult. So I said, how does this work? Well, it works great for practice. I'm out of shape, so I can't do anything. All I can do is practice. It works great for that, but it doesn't work so great for teaching. Is what I discovered. It is so. At some point, the Holy Spirit said, "Okay, you got it." I mean, so now you got to be a teacher. Now you got to be a Dharma prince. And so to be a Dharma prince, it's a slightly different tactic. Because then I'm going to get pressured and say, hey, you know, forsake them, turn them over to us. You know, don't stop teaching them. And I'm going to have to say, well, you know, man, not right now, I'm not going to. Maybe later, you know, I might agree with you later. And they can see, well, it looks like he's could be agreeable to us. So, you know, so there's less pressure that way. Interesting. So I had to transform myself. I've lost twenty-four pounds, you could say. 24. People call me skinny now, right? Which is juvenile, right? It's a juvenile look. So what the pressure is it would pressure you to give up being a Dharma prince or princess. So when you say no to that, they say, well, yeah, okay, I understand, but that upsets us, so let's make a deal. Give up some of your students or those who you're helping, you know, sacrifice them. We'll accept. You gotta give us some sacrifice. We understand you don't want to sacrifice yourself, but you sacrifice somebody else for us. You know, turn them over to death. And I have to say, well, you know, I'm not gonna do it right now, but I might do it in the future. It's possible. Yeah, I'm not closing the door on that. Make no mistake about it, the business of absurdity is death. And all this, what we see is the universe and everything, is just death. Is death. Is death. Is death. That's what it is. This is trying to expand death, more death, more death, more death, and death. To absurd death is absurdity made death is a way to get rid of this threat of paranoia of non-being. You know, it's like you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't have non-being and be aware of non-being. You know, you can't be non-being. It's not possible. And we're trying to be non-being, which is absurdity. And absurdity is just a pretension of reality. We're pretending there's really no non-being at all. But we think, oh, there's no non-being. Well, then my being is nothing at all. You know, it's an abyss. It's not even non-being. It's an abyss. This is absurdist logic, right? If there's no non-being, how can we be non-being? We can't have a being of non-being in the first place. So it's only pretending. But we want to say, no, it's not pretending. We're actually doing it, which is a very juvenile attitude, isn't it? We want to separate from God. It says, God, we're going to be our own prime creator. So we're separate from being. We now have, we're being non-being, and we're going to expand that. But as soon as we get rid of the paranoia of losing the non-beingness. So first we have to kill that paranoia, so we have to fixate and project the threat and kill all the threat. And then once we're done with that, then we'll get around to the business of being a new prime creator of the realm of non-being. We just have this little problem, God, you know, with paranoia, but it's pretty severe, but we're diffusing it through all this death, and we'll get rid of it pretty soon. You know, this is what we're doing. This is what we're trying to do. This is what this dream is what it's about. So we've gone over a lot here, haven't we? Almost 2 hours. Yeah, a lot of me. Yeah. So it's a wow. So like, wow, we're, you know, maybe we can succeed. I thought we're cooked. Maybe we're not cooked. Maybe we don't have to dream. Maybe, you know, like, wow, we don't. Maybe I can be that Dharma prince and princess that I know I really am. maybe I don't have to keep outsmarting myself. You know, maybe I see the trap. Oh, wow. So let me just be humble about it, be an adult about it, a spiritual adult. So don't try to remember what's said here at this point. You know, the hearing is in the moment. This is not academia where you're memorizing, you got notes, and then you're going to go back and find out what was really said. No, it's you're always listening in the now, like you're getting it now. You're being impacted right now. And then you go into the wow later on. You say, okay, I did it. I listened to this, I heard it, I and wow. So for me, now let me put this video up and put it out there for the world. That's a big wow. It's a very, very important video. And that for me, that's the next step. So I'm not dwelling on what I said. I already said it. Now I got to back it up. See, that's the next step. Back it up. Except this is where I'm at now. Wow. I'm dwelling in the wow of this now. I'm getting used to it, getting familiar with it. You know, so this is where it's at for me. So we end with a little meditation cool down period. A little bird just arrived there. There was a big speckled bird here. I haven't seen one like that before. Black and white speckled bird. When I first started this video, I said, oh my gosh, it flew off. I looked at it. It flew up. And I haven't seen a bird like that around here. Great speckled bird is... it's got some sort of spiritual connotation, doesn't it? Absolutely, it does. So it is black and white, cut and dried. Very interesting. So we end by a cool down, reminding ourselves we're commit to the court of the Dharma King. Just make that commitment. Say, I'm committed to it. Sure, I'm going to be troubled. I'm committed to some more trouble. Right? But being troubled by truth. So commit to that cool down video here of focusing some Dharma Kingness here. Beyond any aim, just the presence, all praise to the Dharma King. Who is supportive of our endeavor here, supportive, absolutely supportive of it. Dharma, spiritual protection.